Hello my friends and welcome again to my video channel. Next project is repair and restoration of this old Grundig RC generator TG5, type TG5. It's an RC generator operating from 10 Hz to approximately 1 MHz, adjustable here with these knobs. Variable output, sine and square wave settings here. Can be used also as a frequency counter, but only 4 digits. It's not so exact, but it's not a counter, it's more or less only a generator. It's from the early 70s or late 60s. I found the documentation, 1971. It's this rig here is nearly, the equipment here is nearly 50 years old. I got it on an internet auction here for some euros. The seller promised it is not operating. It has some problem, and yes, it has some problem. But in general, it's in very good condition. I'll show you some details. The front here, as I told, is very clean. With these knobs, the frequency ranges can be selected. The actual frequency is here indicated. The frequency can be tuned here with this knob. And this is the first problem. The knob is nearly stuck. It doesn't move, only with some power, some force, which is not so good. And the variable frequency is made by the variable capacitor. And behind this knob, there is not a gear. There is a transmission with a cord onto the variable capacitor, like an old radio. You know it maybe from the old radios with the moving pointer. But instead of the pointer, there is a digital display. And there is also a problem. You see when I chose a lower frequency range, some digits are lost. This makes no sense. Always 400 here. Here is a digit lost. Don't know why exactly. Output is still there, as you can see. We can change it. Select a different attenuator setting. We can go down up to 1 mV full scale. 1 mV full scale, it's very good for any audio stages to test. But the counter here is beyond any reasonable. Ah, now the dot is also appearing here. Sometimes it's not appearing when I press it a little bit. So it's a lot of work to be done. I will check it first with a scope and a frequency generator, how this counter here is working and where the problem is. But I fear there's a lot of work to be done. The first check is to measure the output voltage and output frequency here. I'm in the range 100 to 1000 Hertz. This is the output here, going into the scope here. The range is set to 1 V effective maximum. I can increase the voltage here to indication 100, that means 1 V, and I have here 500 mV per division, so it is 1.5 V or nearly 3 V peak to peak. That's in line with 1 V effective, root mean square. So it's, this seems to be okay, can be adjusted here down to 0. Okay, not so bad. Sine wave, square wave, as expected. You see the frequency indication is nonsense. The actual frequency is 888 Hz, 0.889887 kHz. I cannot tune the frequency here. It's very hard to rotate the knob here. I don't know what is happening here. I go one step higher. It's approximately factor 10. The actual frequency here is now 9.4 kHz. Indication is 5540 Hz. Okay, it's anywhere, but not what's expected here. Next step here, frequency is 91.98 kHz. It's 91 kHz here. It's between 10 and 100 kHz. No chance to change it here. Again, sine and square wave is okay. Frequency is unchanged. Next step is 100 to 100 kHz to 1 MHz, yes, 100 to 1000 kHz. indication is 400 hertz. Yes, okay. Actual frequency is 757 point something kilohertz. So this frequency here is in line with the setting here, but again, no chance to tune it. Okay, that's not so good. Frequency indication here is completely out of range. I will check it with an external signal, because the internal frequency counter here can be used also for external measurement, and I will feed in an external frequency from a signal generator and we can see what happens. The next check is the frequency counter here. As I told you, this counter can be used also for measurement of external frequencies here. I've selected here on this generator a sine wave of 500 kHz. I measure it on the scope here, 499.99 and something, so it is 500 kHz. I switch here to go to in, frequency measurement 0.3, I have a 500 millivolts, so it is above the threshold. Measuring is 40 something hertz, not so good. I change the frequency here, let me say 100 kilohertz. You see what I see, 5 something, 0, frequency 50 kilohertz, 350 hertz, and so on, you see. Complete nonsense here on this indication here. It is a frequency counter based on TTL circuits with Nixie tubes, you see. I assume there's something rotten, maybe the voltage supply, the 5 volt for the TTL is not okay or something else. After removal of the case here, 2 screws had to be loosened on the bottom side here. I can see that the reason for the stuck drive here is seems to be here in the part where the variable capacitor is. The knob here is slipping on this axis here, but it makes no sense to make it more tight here, because as you see the cord here loses its tension. So I'm quite sure that the problem is inside here, so I have to open this case here, unsolder it also on the side here, look into it and see what happened to the variable capacitor. The shield here of the RC oscillator part can be removed rather easily, unsoldering some points here where it is soldered together here, using some braid here, some flux, vacuum pump and so on, with the standard methods. So it can be taken away, and now we have access to the capacitor here. And we see the problem here. One moment, I readjust the camera. This wheel here and the fins of the capacitor here don't move. The rope here itself is okay, the cord here, but the capacitor here is completely stuck, so I have to clean the drive here with some drops of oil, maybe some solvent also, I will dry it. For this purpose I will add some paper under beneath it to avoid something dropping onto the circuit here. Would be not so good if some of the solvent is dropping onto the circuit board here. And then I can clean it here. And it's always a good idea to work with gravity and not against gravity. So I placed this generator here on one side here, this side up. And now I can add the solvent with the siring here exactly into the gear here and hope it makes it a little better, more flexible. Seems there's a lot of oil inside here, which is hard, so this wheel here cannot move. Up to now I have no success. I think I have to wait some minutes until it's better. Some minutes later, using some force also onto this wheel here by hand, and some deoxid D100L exactly into this gear here, the variable capacitor suddenly moved overall over 180 degrees. You hear it a little bit, it's a little bit noisy. So I hope when I use now this oil here, it's also with some graphite for greasing it, that it becomes quiet and then I have a good status. I don't want to remove the capacitor out of the equipment here because it's a little bit complicated with this cord here to save it, not to lose it and so on. So I try to clean it inside here. It's not the best way I know, but on the other hand, I think it will be also good to clean it inside here and hope it's good for another decade here. I will grease it and then we will see what happens. And in such cases, don't forget these bearings here also. This mechanism here, it's metal, so it can also accept some drop of oil here. So it moves rather easy now, also here, onto this axis here and here. It's all metal, as long as it is metal, it's not a problem to grease it. Metal accepts greasing. Plastic would be dangerous, because plastic would accept the oil and maybe it would swell up, so it's not a good idea. Plastic always wants to run dry, but this here is a good idea for metal. Now it's running rather good here, as you see. I think it was enough work now. I'm lucky not to have to remove the capacitor here, because it's a little bit complicated with this drive here, with this cord here and so on. So I would have to fix it outside, and I'm not sure how to do it. It would be a little bit dangerous to lose everything here and to have completely rewire it. I will let it sit overnight here and wait what happens tomorrow. But I'm thinking it's okay now, and I can live with it. It's a little bit hard again, but the problem is here are no wheels here. And on the lower side here, it's only a plastic, and the cord here only slides over it. This doesn't rotate here. It's a sort of mechanical resistance, which can be felt here on the front knob here. Whether it is intended to make it a little bit harder to move, I'm not sure, but it's a consequence here of this construction here. So there's a limit. It cannot be moved very easily. There's always some resistance caused by these two plastic parts here, and the cord here is rather strong here over it, bended over it over 90 degrees. So I think it's more or less intended. It would have been easier to install here some small wheels here which rotates, but I don't want to change the mechanism here, because the cord length then wouldn't be okay and so on. So I leave it as it is. It's okay, but we have to know that this is some resistance here, not only the gear here and here inside, it's also here some resistance. Well, I let sit it overnight to get the oil into the mechanism here and see how it looks tomorrow. And now a first check whether the drive here with the cord is okay. The generator output here is connected to the scope input here. I'm in the range between 100 kHz and 1000 kHz. That means 1 MHz on the right position here. And when I go to 500 nanoseconds, I see the frequency is a little bit more than 1 MHz. The space is a little bit less than 1 microsecond. And going down here, it's now rather easy to tune it here, as you see. No problems. Go down to 100 kHz. It's lower settings. It's 10 microsecond, a little bit more than 10 microsecond, 5 microseconds, 10, 11, 11 or 12 microseconds, so it's less than 100 kilohertz. Next range is 10 kilohertz here. Which is 100 microseconds. You see it's a little bit less than 100, a little bit more than 100 microseconds, 50, 100, yes. Tuning up to should be 100 kilohertz. Here, in some positions of the variable cap, there are some problems with the oscillation. Maybe there's a contact problem in the capacitor here. The distance is 7 microseconds, yes. It's a little bit more than 100 kilohertz and so on. All ranges are okay now. It's between 1000 hertz and 10 kilohertz. One interesting effect I can show you on the lowest range, 10 to 100 hertz. If you see this here, I go to digital storage mode. And something refresh. It's not the problem of the camera. It's a reality here. What you see here, the reason is the oscillator is not shielded in the moment. The frequency is around the 15 milliseconds. When I go down to 20 milliseconds, 5, 10, 15. This is an oscillation of 50 hertz coming out from the oscillator and 50 hertz from the line frequency. This is a mixture of both frequencies. The case is not shielded here, and when I add the shielding here of the case, and press a little bit down, so it's gone. So it is absolutely necessary to have a shielding of those oscillators for very low frequencies. Otherwise, there are such effects to be observed here. It's ugly, very ugly here. Again. Shielding, everything is okay. Well, this is an indication for me that the oscillator part and the output is working. Also the square wave output here, you can see the amplitude is okay. It is set to 1 volt output here. I have 500 millivolt per division here, so it is 1 volt square wave peak. In the sine wave we have 1 volt root mean square, 500. It's 1300 or 1400 millivolt. Is it true? Ah, it's not the maximum here, a little bit less than. Okay. This is nearly okay with the indication on the meter here. It is in line with the output here. So I think the oscillator part itself seems to be okay. The problem is the counterpart. I have to check all supply voltages now and see what happens, what I can find. Maybe some electrolytic caps are out of order, or some voltage stabilizers and so on, or maybe also a digital integrated circuit here. It's built with standard TTL circuits. Good old technique from the last century. TTL SN74 and something else, which is the technology of this counter here. It's not high sophisticated like today. It's good old technique, but the repairability is very good, so I'm quite sure that I will find the fault. The next step is to check the supply voltages. The electrolytic capacitors here inside of this generator are roughly 45 years old, early 70s. So it's a question whether they are still okay, and maybe there's a high ripple in the supply voltages. The first step is I will check the 5 volt, the plus 5 volt, which is to the TTL circuits. This is the input of the, you see here, of the 5 volt regulator. We have 5 volts per division. Sorry, the hold off should be a little bit better here. Okay, the hold off. 5, we have 10. The minimum voltage here is 10 volt and the maximum is 13 volt. So the ripple is not too high here. It is acceptable. And the output voltage here is exactly 5 volt. That is ground, plus 5 volt here. I will reposition the camera and focus it a little bit better on the screen of the scope so you will see it better. And again, the check of the plus 5 volt. Please consider when you read here 500 millivolt. The probe is 10 by 1, so it is 5 millivolt per division. Sorry, here's the input to the regulator. It's an integrated circuit. Minimum is here 10 volt up to 13 volt. And the output is exactly 5 volt here, as it should be. No ripple on it, no oscillations. It's clear, fine, nice signal as it should be. And now let's go to the other voltages, especially plus minus 24 volt. First we check the plus 24 volt. This is the output, 10, 20, 24 volt. This is the input of the transistor. It's a serial stabilized transistor, 10, 20, 30. Nearly 40 volt. Sorry, the triggering is not stable here. Okay, now it's okay. And this again is the base voltage here. Okay, this is as it should be. And now the negative voltage here, minus 24 volt output. Input is okay. I should go to 20 volt, 20, 40, a little bit more than 40 volt. And this is the output, 24 volt. So we can say the 24 volt plus minus is okay. The output voltages here are also clean, and the electrolytic capacitors seem to be okay for this purpose of stabilizing and filtering the ripple out, so the supply voltages can be considered as good. Another voltage is a supply for the Nixie voltage, for the Nixie tubes here. It's 170 volt. This is the output of the rectifier here. You see a small ripple. We have 10, we have 100 volt per division, so a little bit about 200 volt. This is the side on the stabilizing here. It's 170, yes, 120, 40, 60, 160 volt. Ground is not very precise here. Okay, it's 120, 40, 60 is 170 volt. So it's also okay. We have seen the Nixie tubes are working properly, so this voltage is obviously okay. The next step is to clean the switching contacts here for the frequency ranges, because these contacts here also have a direct influence on the counter unit. This counter unit could be rather easily removed here from the generator here. Only three screws had to be taken away. One, two, and the third one was a bolt here. So this unit, which was placed here, could be taken out. This hole here is from the axis of the drive of the capacitor here. It's also easy to remove it. So we have the advantage here to have this unit out to check it separately. but in the moment I have good access and clean the contacts here. Maybe it's that some of the odd behavior of this counter is caused by bad contacts here. So it's always a good idea, next step, to clean the contacts before looking for any electronic fault inside the counter unit. And if you may ask how to clean these switches here, these sliding switches, without completely removing them, there are holes in it here for the spring mechanism here, these holes here. And they are sufficient to spray some contact cleaner into it, and it will drift down here through the whole switch here. And you see it's a little bit wet here also. I never sprayed here, I only spread here. Used to spray here, but it came out here. There's also a small hole here. Anyway, we can't see. Ah, yes. A little bit difficult to see at the moment, because it's not so optimal. But there are also here small holes where it comes out again. So you spray in here and it comes out here. And if it comes out here, it's a good indication that the whole switch here over the whole length is full of contact cleaner, and then it's sufficient only to activate it sometimes from time to time to clean the contacts and keep the fingers crossed that it is good enough. During the first check of the counter unit, I have seen that the indication of the hertz and kilohertz is not correct. There are two bulbs in it. One for the hertz, and another bulb is for the kilo. So then we have kilohertz. For kilohertz indication, both have to be lit, and for hertz only one is lit. But only the hertz indication was okay. I don't know whether the bulbs are not okay or the switching contacts here. I have here a voltage, approximately 16 or 18 volt DC. The bulbs are for 24 volts, but both are okay, as you see. I can apply here voltage. And if I go to the other bulb here, this one is also okay. So both bulbs are okay here, as you see. So if we have a non-indication of one bulb, the problem is not the bulb itself. It must be elsewhere. I assume in the context of the switch, of the range switch. We have the first success here now. I'm using this generator only as a counter. Frequency measurement is in, and depending upon the position of the frequency range, also the indication hertz, kilohertz, and the dot appears or disappears. Now we have kilohertz indication, and there's a dot which has not been before. The dot jumps here in the megahertz range, so it looks rather good here. And here we are in the hertz ranges. Now I apply an external frequency here from a frequency generator to this input here, and there's again the wrong indication here, but the used frequency is, let me say, it is 10 kilohertz. Is it true? Yes, it's 10 kilohertz. There is an error in it, because we would be here. I go down one step. Now I have rather exactly 1 kilohertz here, which is indicated here. Then there should be a 1, which is not true here, but in this mode we have here 1 kilohertz. When I increase it to 11 kilohertz, so 1.1, no reaction here. Ah, here is it. I have here 1.6. Sorry, I made a mistake here. It was my fault here. I have to go here and here. It's 2 kilohertz. Ah, now it's correct. Sorry, I was not on the right track here. 100 times 10, it's 1 kilohertz here. The frequency I'm generating at the moment is 1 kilohertz. I increase it to 2 kilohertz.
3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. The 9 here is a little bit a problem here of the last digit always. 9, and that's 10. And this would, should be 1, but it is 5, and it should be 0. So it's an indication that the problem is in the third digit here. When I go back to 9, I increase it from 9.0, 9.1, it's indicated 9.2 and so on. I can count up here, 9.9, and 10 again, it's 5. We had 4 with sometimes a 4 here. This is for me a clear indication that the problem is in the counter part here, where the counter integrated circuits are, which are counting not in the latch circuits and not in the decoder to the NICs here, because this digit here, the fourth digit, is always wrong. When I increase the frequency, I have here in the moment 9 kilohertz. When I go to 90 kilohertz, there should be 0, not the 4. So there is something with a digit 4 which is shifted horizontally. So I'm quite sure the problem is in the counting part here. It's a standard TTL circuit, and I have to look what's happening in this third digit here. So this is, in my opinion, in the moment, the main problem here. These two digits are okay here. And again, another check at the lower end of the frequency range here in the hertz range. I've chosen the frequency range 10 to 100 hertz here. Only hertz is lit, not kilohertz like here on the hertz. And I'm feeding in a frequency of exactly 10 hertz here. And you see it is indicated 10 hertz. I go up to 20 hertz. Okay, 20. Increase here now the unit here. 21, 22, why doesn't, okay, here is it takes always a second or so, because the time interval is a second now. Five and so on, I go down to zero here, go up to 30 hertz. Forty hertz and so on. Fifty. 60, 70, 80. I have now 80 hertz, 90 hertz. And now I go to 100 hertz. There should be 100 again. Not 1, it is 5. And here appears a figure 1, which should be definitely 0. Now I can increase the frequency to 1000 hertz, then there should be a 0. Okay, I have 1000 hertz here. I go down to 100 hertz, same result again as before. 200, 300, 500, 500. There's a 3 here, okay. But I definitely have 500 hertz, 600. This is always okay, the last two digits, but the first two, the leading two, are wrong. And it's always the third digit here, which is definitely wrong. I've checked the counter circuit carefully from outside as good as I can do. I want to avoid to be on the wrong track. To do everything I can do from outside to identify the faulty IC. Now I go a little bit more inside. That's the circuit here of the counter itself. Here we have the SN7490N4 integrated circuit. This is a divider 10 by 1, 4 times. It's a known circuit from those days. These are the latches or the of the storage where the result of the counter is stored. And these are the drivers for the Nixie tubes here. My next attempt is, I've taken the board out, I'll show you, to give here an input signal, well, let me say 100 kilohertz or so, and to see whether all the counters here are working properly, and dividing by 10 and giving also here outputs to the storage ICs, to the latches here, or not, where the problem is. And we have, as we have seen, the problem is the third one here, is this one here. So I expect this and this works okay. Here something will be wrong, and maybe this is good again here, I'm not sure. So I will check it. To do this, I have to interrupt the wire here, to cut the wire here from the logic here, to feed in a circuit here. This is a reset pulse for the counters here. It has to be grounded to avoid any problems with this here. And here I have to feed in this plus 5 volt and ground. So this part here can work. There is no problem that other ICs are also fed with plus 5 volt here. I don't have 180 volts here on the line here, don't need it in the moment. I only want to consider these four counters here and to see what they are doing. And now to the test setup. I've taken the counter board out. This is the backside, and here are the four counters I'm looking for. This is plus minus 5 volt DC supply. This here is the input. Oh, you can see it here on the picture. This is the power supply here, plus minus 5 volt. And this is the input here from the generator. I'm using a square wave of 100 kilohertz from my square wave generator. And this is a, my scope here, two channel scope to measure the inputs and outputs of the different stages. First I go to the first counter here, where the 100 kilohertz is coming in. This pin 14 here. Okay. I'm measuring here in the moment the input here at this one, pin 14, 100 kilohertz here input. And the output is at pin 11. Yes, output is here at pin 11, which is the input to pin 14 of the next unit. So I go here to the output. Pin 11, I go to 14, the next input here. It's a little bit easier to use the probe here. Make triggered by B. So I can see input, output, and it's vector 10. To one pulse here, there are belonging 10 pulses. Oops. Not so good. So I'm a little bit difficult here, maybe I use the output here. Okay, we can see exactly division by 10 of the first stage. No surprise, because the first stage is operating very well, so I don't expect anything other. Now we go to the second stage input. And this is the output here. Same picture. Input, output. One pulse here equals 10 pulses here. So the second stage is also operating with input and output. And we have seen the last two digits are okay. I think, please vice versa. What is here left is right on the display. I've turned it around by 180 degrees. And now let's go to the third. Unit where I assume there is a fault. Oops. It's a little bit difficult here.
And what do we see here? Input and output is a factor 2. There is something wrong. The third digit is counting wrong, definitely wrong. There's a factor 2 and not a factor 10. Factor 5 is missing. And if we go to the last one here, sorry, I have to hold it by hand. Cannot clamp it here, it's too small here. It's again factor 10. It's a little bit of low frequency here, but it's factor 10 again. One pulse here is 10 pulses here. So the last digit is okay, but it gets the wrong number from the third digit. So the fault is identified in the third stage as assumed. And I'm quite sure that the SN7490 in the third stage is not okay. Well, what does it mean? It means I have to exchange it. It's a little bit difficult here because PCBs are soldered rectangular. I have to unsolder it here, take everything apart here, and then to get access here, because otherwise I cannot unsolder it. Carefully take plus and minus away here, because it's all underneath the tubes here that I cannot get access here in another way. Maybe I will try it, but I'm quite sure I have no chance to get it in without removing it. I have to loosen the screw here. I will try it. Maybe I can leave them in place here and have a chance, but as I see here, there is no chance for me to do it in another way here, to come to a solution here. It's very difficult here to get the IC in place again. I will think about it and show you the result. I decided to separate both circuit boards here. It was not so difficult as I thought before, using some braid here. This holding braid and some flux, it was possible to remove it here, and I hope I didn't cause any damage here, but it looks rather good here. All the contacts, all the wires and traces are still present here, as I see. No damage, and even on this side here also that the wires are here present. So I think I can insert them again, and on the other side here is only some ground connection here, or not even ground, it's only to fix it. That's what I wanted. Now I have good access here to the ICs here and can exchange them. And the second possibility is I can clean these tubes here, they are rather dirty here. Decades of dust are there, and the lamps here also. So it was a good idea to remove it. To get this integrated circuit, the SN7490 out, I used a plier here. I had no other chance. Using the unsoldering pump and so on was not good, because the wires are not so fixed on the PCB, and I feared to make something wrong here and to delete something. So I have not the chance to move out pin by pin. And this IC is kaput anyway, so I have to throw it away. It was the easiest way for me. The new SN7490N is in again. And now the frequency ratio is 10 by 1, as it should be. Input, output here, and the third IC here, 1, 2, 3, it's the third position here. Now it's okay, and I'm quite sure that the counter will work now. I will clean it, make a visual inspection, bridge the cuts I made here. By the way, I've forgotten to mention that the places where I decided to make some cuts, like here, like I said, it's necessary to have a cut here and here. I found there were still cuts. There was somebody else
in this counter before me, and he made cuts, and seems he had the same idea. Why he didn't change the integrated circuit, I don't know. But obviously he stopped his work for any reasons, which I don't know. Anyhow, now the counter is repaired. I reassemble it, and I will show you with the result. And here's the result. The TG5 is reassembled again. Shielding is not in place here. I will install the shield later. The sync output here is connected to a frequency counter. And now we can see all digits are here present. They're available here, can be tuned. I'm in the range from 100 kHz to 1000 kHz here. I can tune it up and down as I want it. The full scale here, 254 something. 1921 and so on. It's rather precise. I will just talk about the precision of this counter here. In general, it works. There's one thing I don't understand in the moment. When I go to 1000 kHz, okay, 996, 9958 and so on. Jumps to zero, and when I increase the frequency, it always indicates zeros. I don't know why and how. I always thought if there is an overflow, then these will be indicated maybe, but the counter itself will show the other digits here. But it is in general not so. And when I go exactly down under 1 MHz here, it's present again here. I have to look into the schematic what this is. But anyhow, I'm satisfied with the result. It works. And let's go to a lower frequency here. We are in the range of 5.4 kHz and so on. Indication is Hertz here. And the frequency range is always 1 to 10 below 1 kHz. And here's the same topic with the zeros here. When I go beyond 10 kHz here, beyond 11 kHz here, and then it comes back again here. I don't understand it in the moment, I admit. I will look into the schematic, why this happens here, but I think it's in general so with this sort of generator. Well, in principle it works again, and I have to do some cleaning and so on. And then one big decision I have to make is whether to change all electrolytic caps or not. In the moment there are all original caps inside. I've seen one or two caps which have problems with some corrosion in the plus pole where it comes out. Between the rubber and the plus pole, there is something not very clean. Maybe I have to look at it. But in general, the most important thing is that it works. I have to check the CHD, the distortion and so on, how good it is or how bad it is. But these are other topics here. Okay, that's it for the moment. Next scene, I will show you how to continue. In one of the last scenes we discussed the question whether the overflow here, which indicates zeros here, is okay in this way, whether it's a bug or it's a feature. In many cases with a strange behavior, it's useful to read the manual. Read first the manual. To prevent errors when exceeding the maximum frequency which could be displayed, a circuit is provided which in such a case returns the counter to zero. That's clear, and it means when you go up a little bit in the frequency here, 990, 988, 999, then we have 00. Here should be a 1 and something, but it is set to 0. When we reduce the frequency again, we are below This is 9,941 Hertz here. Nearly 10 kilohertz. There's a circuit in, and I've a little bit looked at the schematic, and I found the circuit, how it works. The principle of the circuit is rather simple but effective. The counting pulses and frequencies coming in here, 1, 10, 100, 1000. And always when it's coming to the 10th pulse, there's one overflow to the next, and so on and so on. But this is 1000, and there is no other decade which can be indicated here. So that this first pulse, which would go normally to the next decade here, which isn't present here, is fed back here by this circuit here, following this line here. It's the overflow indication. It goes to this, let me say, wait a moment, to this flip-flop. It's a dual flip-flop here, 7473, and the Q negative goes low. It's the input, as I see, it's a clock input, and this goes to low, comes back here, and via this input here of the dual NAND, when this goes low, this goes high. And this creates a reset here. Normally it's in an end would also go low, but it's an inverted end, so it goes high. And this is a reset pulse. And this reset pulse here is fed to all four counters and it resets them to zero. That means when there appears an overflow, which cannot be transferred to the next decade, it comes back here as a reset pulse to all four decades here and sets them down to zero until the next sequence of measurement, the next gate period starts. For this time, the counters here are blocked. It's rather easy and effective. Other circuits of such counters would have here an indication for the overflow, would catch it in the LED or something like this. Okay, the engineers in those days decided to set all the four decades to zero here. It's also a solution. The most important thing for me is it's not a bug, it's really a feature. It is intended and it works, as we have seen. So I can say this part of the circuit is also okay and needs no further repair. We can live with it. That's a solution here for the overflow. One of the problems we didn't discuss up to now is this sliding pot here, which stuck sometimes. It is not so easy to move it, to tune it. Sometimes it's a little bit stuck there. So I took it out here, unsoldered it, made some notes how it was connected, of course, not to a lot of wires there. And then I've disassembled it. Now it lays here. It was rather easy to open it. It looks like this here. And there are two pins on both sides here. Let me show it. One pin is here coming out, and the other pin is here. I had only to pinch off the plastic cap, and then it can be taken apart here. And we have access to the interior, and it can be cleaned rather easily now. And we have two parts here. It was some dirt inside, and this plastic slide here didn't move easily because there was dust here inside both sides here where it runs. There's also a plastic type here. This runs here inside in this slot here. It takes around here. Oh, sorry, there's some dust here. It runs about 360 degrees here. And this slot, it's intended to close it to avoid any dust and other small parts coming into it, to have a protection here when the slide here is moving, and there's always a part which is not covered here, and this tape here covers it. But this tape here seems to have a little bit of problem here. It's a little bit damaged here. I'm not sure whether you can see it here. On this side here, it is a little bit black. On both sides here, it seems that it has been a little bit squeezed or something like this.
and it's rough here on the edge here, on both edges here in the part. Other part is okay here, there's no problem. I will cut away this edge here. It's not so critical. When it's a little bit smaller, doesn't matter. It's still broad enough to cover the gap here. It's only necessary to cover a small part here. The gap is not so big, so we can accept it. And then I hope I can use this tape again, because it's rather difficult to get a new tape here. Such tapes are not so easy to get, and I don't know how to get it. The contacts here can be cleaned rather easy. This metal here is a sliding contact for the center contact here, and the graphite here is the resistor here. To grease it, in general, plastic runs dry, it needs no greasing. Don't use any oil or something like this. I need here, or will use here, only a drop of PTFE, or also called as Teflon, in this gap here on both sides here. So this plastic slide here moves a little bit easier. Teflon has an advantage. It doesn't attack or doesn't delete the plastic here. It's neutral for plastic. I think you could also use some silicone grease or something like this, but don't use oil. Oil is dangerous, because oil is the same product as plastic, so the oil would be accepted by the plastic here and could dissolve it. So maybe if the plastic would a little bit swell, and it's a problem. I will do it, and then I will close this resistor here again and see how good it works. This potentiometer here is ready. I cut the tape as discussed. This is rest here from the edges here, 0.5 millimeter on each side. I took a very sharp pair of scissors here. This one here, snip, snap, snip, snap. And it was rather easy to cut it on both sides here. And now it moves smoothly, very smoothly, as it should here. I also added some PTFE or Teflon, as discussed. Here I melted the bolts here again, these pins here, where I pinched off the head of it. It was still enough plastic. I used a small soldering iron here for this purpose, like this here. It has at 12 volt, it has 8 watts. It's not good for soldering really, but it's good for melting plastic. When using 10 volt here, it's the input here, it's the power here. So I could melt here and here, and also here on the side. I made a small trace here with melted plastic here to close it reliable. An idea would be also to drill a hole here vertically, 2 millimeter or 1.5 millimeter. For screw, M1.5 or M2 screws here, very small screws on both sides, but I think it's okay now here. I've measured the resistance also. Now it is very smooth here, as it should be. I will bring it into the generator again, wire it or rewire it and check it, and then I can continue. The potentiometer is in place again here. And now you can see it's very easy to adjust now. It is smooth, can be adjusted with two fingers here. It doesn't stuck any longer. And also it's very precise here in the range of millivolt and so, whatever it is needed. And it can be adjusted over the full scale here. There's some millivolts missing on the right hand here in the range of 1 or 10. Should be a little bit higher here. Go up to 100, but it's another topic. I'm sure it's a question of calibration and so on. Well, this job is done, and now let's go to the next topic. After repairing the digital display here, cleaning the pot here for the output voltage, cleaning the contacts here, I decided to make a first measurement regarding specification, whether the specification is met or not. I didn't change throughout all the electrolytic and tantalum capacitors. The capacitors which are inside there, they are roughly more than 40 years old. I expect 40 or 45 years, but I try to keep them. I will see what happens. I didn't investigate them in detail. So I make first a measurement. One of the most important measurements, of course, is the distortion analysis. It's a setup, it's a generator here. Case is closed, fully closed, to avoid any noise, hum, etc. from outside coming in. The shield for the generator is also in place here. Here is a distortion analyzer, the famous HP334A with automatic mode here. The output here of the generator is fed to the scope here and also to the analyzer here input. And the bridge output, which shows us the distortion, only the distortion is fed to the second channel here of the scope here. So we have two traces here. It's the input signal of the analyzer, which equals the output of the generator. And this is the output of the bridge here, where we can see later the distortion. And we, I will measure between 10 Hertz and 600 kilohertz as it is specified in the manual. In steps 10, 3, 10, 3, and so on. Why only up to 600 kHz? Well, the manual specifies only 600 kHz as maximum frequency for distortion analysis. I don't know why they didn't go up to 1 MHz, but it is in the manual stated. And as I see here, this distortion analyzer here from Hewlett-Packard is also only designed for measurement up to 600 kHz. Maybe the engineers at Grundig who developed this generator here only had such a bridge here and couldn't measure up to higher than 600 kHz therefore. So they said, okay, we stop at 600 kHz and didn't measure up to 1 MHz, maybe, I don't know. Well, the procedure is obviously the same here. I set the pointer here in the set level with the vernier to the 100% position, that's here. I can show you a little bit the picture here. I try to make it a little bit better. And then I can go to distortion here. And then the bridge has to be set. I'm in the range of 1 kHz. 1000 Hertz is 1 kHz here. 100 times 10, the bridge. Therefore, you have seen that when I go to analyze, the bridge output is nearly zero. I have to tune the frequency. I can go a little bit higher in sensitivity. First I have to reduce amplitude here with the frequency, then with the balance. There's another balance here, resistive balance, to notch it out completely. Then I can further increase the sensitivity. And with the auto mode here, when I go to the auto mode here, the bridge automatically tunes to zero. It's a photoelectric method with two photoresistors and so on. And then I can go to the maximum sensitivity, 0.1% full scale, 0.02 something, 0.02%. It's a very good value for this generator here. At full output of 10 volts here, and you see here the picture of the output here of the ripple here. I will store it. One moment, please. Make it a little bit more stable. Erase it. Okay, now read. Oh, it's a little bit too much intensity. Sorry again, the camera is very sensitive here. Okay, now it's better. It's more or less the harmonics here you see, and there's sometimes a switching which can be seen. I may assume it is a switching of the generator, of the square wave generator inside. I don't know exactly. Well, I will do it from all frequencies, from 10 Hertz up to 600 kilohertz. Note it on the list here. Make a paper. It's not necessary to show you each step, and then we can discuss the results. And this is the result of the THD measurement. Between 10 Hertz and 100 Hertz, it should be less than 1.5%. It is 0.5, 0.2, and so on. Between 100 Hertz and 1 kilohertz, it should be 0.5%. It is 0.05, and so on. Even in the range between 1 kilohertz and 10 kilohertz, where it should be less than 0.1%, it is 0.022, and so on. Even in the higher ranges, between 30 kilohertz and 100 kilohertz, where it should be less than 0.5%, it is 0.051, 0.17. And in the highest frequency range, it's getting a little bit worse. Between 100 kilohertz and 600 kilohertz, it is specified with less than 1%. It is 0.1 up to 0.59% at 600 kilohertz. So we can assume that at 1 megahertz, the distortion is getting worse, but doesn't matter. 600 kilohertz with 0.59. This is the measurement here. You can see 600 kilohertz. And we have 1% full scale. We have 0.59. So we are still here, also in the range within specification at 600 kilohertz here. Okay, that means the THD measurement doesn't bring any problem. We are very good within specification, partially with factor 2, factor 5 or less than specified. So we can be satisfied. To measure the rise and fall time of the square wave output of this generator here. The generator is connected to the scope input here via this short coax cable and a 50 ohm termination here. If you may ask why I'm using a 50 ohm termination, it's necessary to have a perfect termination for such a coax cable, otherwise the measurement is wrong. The output impedance is 200 ohm here specified, but it doesn't matter, it's an ohmic output here. And when I load an ohmic output with a different ohmic load, then we have only a voltage division. There's a voltage divider, which reduces the output voltage, but the shape of the square wave itself is constant, and rise and fall times is not affected as long as the circuit, the whole circuit is ohmic. And it is ohmic because we have here 1 megohm parallel 50 ohm. It's 50 ohm, 50 ohm cable. The impedance here is 50 ohm. Source impedance 200 ohm, so we have a voltage divider 1 to 5. This only affects the height of the amplitude, but not the shape itself. And now let's have a better look at the screen here. You can see here, I'm not sure whether that's okay, whether you see dotted line 0% and the other dotted line on the top here, top and bottom, 0, and here's 100%. To measure the rise time, I use a second time base here. Show both time bases. Then the delay time base only and the magnifier. That's it. A little bit more intensity, a little bit more focus. Okay. We have here delay time base with a setting of 0.1 microsecond, that is 100 nanosecond per division. Magnifier, so we have 10 nanoseconds per division here. And we can measure the rise time with approximately 80-90 nanoseconds here. It's much less than the specified 50 nanoseconds. And the fall time, we can go to the other side here. It's also 18 nanosecond fall time here. We see no overshoot, nothing, so the square wave is rather good, even for high frequencies. It's 1 megahertz here. I think it's a rather good result here. I'll switch off the delay time base. So we can be quite happy with this result here. it's a good shape for a square wave. We can roughly estimate or calculate the effect of this coaxial cable regarding the rise and fall time. The generator itself has an output impedance of 200 ohms parallel 36 picofarad. The scope has an input impedance of 1 megohm parallel 20 picofarad. So the ohmic resistance here in the circuit is 200 ohm parallel 1 megohm is 200 ohm. And the capacity here is 20 picofarad. The cable itself, let's say, is 50 picofarad or something like this, and another 36 picofarad. So we come roughly totally up to 100 picofarad in parallel with 200 ohms. 200 ohms parallel 100 picofarad is 20 nanosecond time constant. So this 20 nanosecond time constant can be seen here in the rise at fall time here. It's only calculated over the thumb, but it's I think rather okay here. So you see also again how important it is to have a correct termination. Now checking the output voltage in relation to the frequency over the frequency range from 10 Hz to 100 kHz. It is specified in this range for plus minus 1.5%. I've chosen as reference reference level here 100 kHz here, 99 point something here, sorry, a little bit too much here, 10 volts here on this voltmeter here, and now I go down one decade down. It is 10 kHz here, a little bit too much here. We know the effect, the counter shows only zeros. When it's overloaded, 9899, it's a little bit less, it's 9.98. Okay, it's 20 millivolt below. It can be 150 millivolt. 1.5% is related to 10 volt plus minus 150 millivolt. Then we go to 1000 hertz here. It's 9.85, and when choosing, okay, a little bit higher here, it's 200 millivolt below, but we have a range of plus minus, so I should choose the reference level a little bit lower. Then I have also these 200 millivolts deviation also in the range of plus minus 150 millivolts. Now I go down to 10 Hertz here, choose the lowest frequency which is specified here. You see the automatic level control, the time constant is a little bit swinging, it's not reacting instantaneously. So we have here 10 Hertz, you see a little bit the needle here, it's 9.9, go up to 100, okay, 112 or something like this, 9.85, again 1000 here, 9.8, 10 kHz, 9.9, and in the range from 100 kHz to 1 MHz, I can choose 300 kHz here again. It's exactly 1.0, it's exactly 10 volt. And now I'm choosing something in between, not only the start and the end of the scale here. I'm choosing here like something like, let me say, 50 kHz or 40 kHz. Okay, it's exactly 10 volt. It's 9.9, and at 450 Hz, it's 9.85. And at 40 40 Hertz, it is 9.8. So I can say all these frequencies are within the range of plus minus 1.5%. So it's good. And we have there also no problems here with the specification. I'm just asking myself, what's the behavior of the generator between 100 kHz and 1 MHz, because it is specified up to 1 MHz, but the amplitude variation is not specified for this frequency range. So I will check it and have a try. In the highest frequency range, 100 to 1000 kHz, it is set to 100. Level is 1.0, that means 10 volt again. Range is 10 volt. And I increase the frequency now to something like 200 or 250 kHz here. It's a little bit more than 10 volt, but not relevant here. Okay, now I'm in, I've approximately 10.1 volt. It's 1% here. I think this was the highest point here. I will do another check here, different way, as a check for the highest output voltage, and that's this to 10 volt here. Okay. Now this is 10 volt here. So I can read it a little bit easier. I'm here at 1 MHz now. It is minus 100 millivolts. I reduce the frequency. Now I'm exactly at 10 volt here. Again, 10 volt, 10 volt at 600, 10 volt at 500, 300 kilohertz. Okay, it's minus 50 millivolts. By 220, it's minus 100. Minus 100 still. It's minus 100, something like this. Okay. Ah, minus 100 millivolt again. So also in the range between 100 kHz and 1 MHz, the output stability is within the range of plus minus 150 millivolts. So I can say the total frequency range from 10 Hz to 1 MHz has a stability of better than plus minus 1.5%, and I think it's a very good value. And this generator can be used also for high sophisticated measurements in analog circuits. And now, my friends, we are at the end of this project of repairing this generator here. We had a faulty display here with a faulty counter. The decade counter SN7490 was bad. The tuning here was a little bit stuck. The variable capacitor didn't move as it should. This pot here was also not so good. It was not so easy to move as it should. It's repaired, contacts are cleaned, and some other minor issues, which I didn't show in detail here, are good. I didn't exchange all capacitors. The electrolytic capacitors are still original. There are 51 capacitors and tantalum caps inside this generator here. I don't see any reason to change them now. I checked all parameters which are relevant. Frequency stability, frequency variation. The counter is checked, whether it's okay. Sensitivity, output stability, versus voltage variation, line voltage variation, and so on. THD, as you have seen, and so on. All important parameters are checked. The generator is okay. I have an idea for two modifications or real improvements, but this is not part of this video. I will stop this project now and say the generator is repaired. It's in its original state as it was 30 or 40 years ago. And the modifications I will show you in a separate video. Stay tuned. Give me some thumbs up or comments, would be nice, and see you later.